Yes, thank you very much for this introduction, and also it's a pleasure. I would like to express my gratitude to, that you invited me to speak to you, and I know this is all quite interesting and challenging. I'd just like to emphasize that when I go through my presentations now, I would like to encourage you to ask questions. So don't, you know, don't feel overwhelmed, because there's maybe a lot of stuff in there, and if I'm losing you in terms of following the content, you know, please ask questions. So what I'd really like to share with you is the immunotherapy development that we have created within a European consortium, and this is shown here. I tried to structure it. So we have developed a chimeric 1418 antibody in Europe for the use for children, and certainly I would like to share with you data that came out of these clinical trials. And I also would like to show to you that this type of treatment also works not only in the front line, but also in patients that have a relapse, and also share with you some future plans that we have, not only with this antibody, but with the overall concept of immunotherapy for this disease. So this slide I'd like to show to you just to acknowledge that in pediatric oncology, we have made progress in some areas more than in others. And the big progress certainly has been in the field of acute lymphoblastic leukemia, and this is shown here on this graph, where in the 70s, the outcome curves, and I'm sure you are familiar with these Kaplan-Meier curves here, which basically shows that over a period of 10 years here, 90% of the patients died. And now we are up here, 90% of the patients surviving acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And with neuroblastoma, that's also improving over time, but we are not as good yet. So we are improving by introducing new treatment elements. You've heard eventually also about more precise treatments, molecular targeted treatments. And these multimodality approaches, they give some improvement over time here, but it stays behind the success of leukemia. And we need to put our effort into further improvement of the outcome for children with neuroblastoma. And that, I think, is why I devoted my career for this purpose, and many others, investigators that you will listen to today, are on a very similar motivation. And my personal goal is to achieve this with an approach that is related to immunotherapy. Now, we have a very unique situation in neuroblastoma, which is the fact that basically all neuroblastoma patients express this particular antigen on the cell surface. It's called ganglioside GD2. And it is a very specific, very particular molecule, because it is not a protein, it is a glycolipid. And it is particular in a way that it is really expressed on neuroblastoma cells and very limited on normal tissue. So when you treat with a specific agent, you don't want to harm normal tissue, you want to really direct this against the tumor. And this is realized in this particular situation. For example, the National Cancer Institute of the United States gives out a list of so-called antigens that are useful for cancer immunotherapy, and within that list, ganglioside GD2 is top 12, which just shows you that it's a good target molecule. And the most advanced concept to exploit GD2 expression up to date is the use of monoclonal antibodies. There has been other approaches which are coming along, such as CAR T cells. You may have heard about that as well. So there you really combine such an antibody with a T cell, so a cell of the immune system, and make this cell specific to the tumor. We have heard about this treatment a lot along this meeting, and it's also very clear that this is a very special treatment. It's not readily available in a very broad area, but it's also not prime time yet for neuroblastoma. It works very well for acute lymphoblastic leukemias, but with solid tumors, the CAR T cells, there needs to be some extra work that needs to be put in. Design of the CAR T cell receptor, but it may eventually come along, but I'm sure it will last at least 1, 2 to 3 years until we can see something that is really working. So I think what the bottom line is that what we have in hands as a tool to really target GD2 to date is anti-GD2 antibodies. And one of these antibodies is shown here. It's CH1418. This antibody has been developed for neuroblastoma quite a long time ago in the United States by Ralf Reisfeld. It's a tumor immunologist. And now this antibody has been developed for clinical application. And the data that has been generated with that, I would like to share with you. So chimeric 1418, like other anti-cancer antibodies, is an antibody that really induces an immune response. So this is the primary mechanism of action. So, and this is shown in that particular cartoon. So the antibody binds to the tumor cell, and then you have cells of the immune system that recognize this antibody that is bound to the tumor cell. And when this happens, you have a release of toxic molecules from the immune cell that then kills the tumor cell. So you really need a functional immune system for this mechanism to happen. There's other cancer, anti-cancer antibodies, like for the treatment of breast cancer, for example, where you have additional mechanisms, where you, for example, block a growth signal. Here you don't have this. GD2 does not have a signaling transduction domain into the cell, but it's only sitting on the surface. And this, so therefore, the immune mechanism is the primary mechanism of action. So there's also some other cells here, like macrophages, that help killing the neuroblastoma. And we have also a complement system. So in the bloodstream, there are serum proteins that also help killing the tumor cell very specifically once the antibody bound to the tumor cell surface. Okay, in order to share with you the results that have been generated so far, I have to go back into the past a little bit, because this antibody has been used in Germany from 1997 to 2002. And the antibody at that time was given to all the children that had neuroblastomas. It was not a randomized clinical trial. But what you can do, and this has been reported in the British Medical Cancer Journal, when you do a retrospective comparison to patients that receive this antibody with patients that did not receive it, so these are the red curves and also the green curve, you see that in this retrospective comparison, there is a signal of activity. And this antibody has been used as a single agent here. So it's not combined with anything else, just the antibody by itself. And on the right-hand side, you see the result of the United States. They have been using chimeric 1418 also, and this time in a randomized clinical trial. But here it was really combined with cytokines. So the antibody was not given as a single agent, but was combined with interleukin-2 and GM-CSF in alternating cycles. And in this randomized clinical trial, there was a premature stop of the study because of superior effects of this combined treatment, indicating that this type of immunotherapy is really clinically relevant to children with neuroblastoma in the consolidation of the treatment. And if you add this information to it, one can speculate that most likely in that mixture, chimeric 1418 is the most important component of the treatment. Now, in Europe at that time, chimeric 1418 was not available to children with neuroblastoma. And therefore, we embarked within the SIOP-N group, which is the European cooperative group dealing with the problem of neuroblastoma, decided to make this antibody available in Europe. And the idea to use SP20 antibody that has been available in the United States and bring this to Europe and make a phase 3 clinical trial in Europe and test in a randomized fashion similar to the LSU study whether this antibody is really helpful. And this failed. It failed for several reasons. One of the reasons was that the mechanism how to produce the antibody could not be transferred over the Atlantic. The cell line that produced this antibody was contaminated with some retroviruses, so it was not possible to prepare the antibody. And therefore, we had to start from scratch. So you need to understand how these proteins are produced a little bit in order to acknowledge that this was a very cumbersome process. So the antibody had to be made new from scratch. In a validated production system. And then when you change the production, you have to re-establish that the antibody did not change in function. So you have to do all the preclinical work, pharmacokinetics, you have to do mouse studies in order to make sure that this antibody is still working the same as previously. And this was all done, but it took 7 years to make this antibody then available for a application in children with neuroblastoma. And this shows the large cooperative study in Europe where this antibody is tested. And since at that time the COG data were already published, we didn't want to randomize against no immunotherapy. Makes sense, because you have already signals of activity, and therefore in Europe we tested another very important question, which is whether this antibody requires really cytokines in addition to it. So we randomized chimeric 1418 in one arm and in the other arm chimeric 1418 plus IL-2. And then I'd like to emphasize that we were lucky that there's a small pharmaceutical company that got interested in that process, took over, and is now trying to get a marketing approval for this recloned antibody. But it really started first as an academic effort. Okay, this is the relatively complicated flowchart of this high-risk neuroblastoma trial. Study chair is Ruth Ladenstein, and it shows the induction treatment, polychemotherapy, followed by high-dose treatments with stem cell transplantation. There is surgery implemented, so the typical elements that you are all aware of that are necessary for successful neuroblastoma treatment. But then in the minimal residual disease phase, there is this randomization. And here are the details of that treatment. So we have the blue boxes here that indicate the application of the antibody. 5 times 20 milligrams per square meter, so the cumulative amount is 100 milligrams per square meter. This is the same like in the United States and also in Germany. It's always used at 100 milligrams per square meter per cycle. And here it is broken up into 5 applications. And one arm was treated with IL-2 and the other arm without IL-2. And the initial results of that randomization is shown here. And that was a little bit surprising to us, because we thought that the interleukin-2 is a cytokine and it stimulates the immune cells so that the effect of the antibody should be better. But the survival curve teaches us that there is no difference. So if you look at the 2-year event-free survival or 3-year event-free survival, if you compare these numbers, so the blue arm is with IL-2, the red arm is without IL-2, there's no difference whatsoever. Now, this is early results, so one always has to be a little bit careful, because if you reanalyze something like this in 5 years or 10 years, there may be some small differences, you never know. But the first impression here is that there are completely overlapping curves. Now we then do a subgroup analysis according to the tumor status before immunotherapy is applied. So there is also patients that had still measurable and evaluable tumor who received that treatment. We can acknowledge that, which is not surprising, that patients that have residual tumor have a little lower event-free survival curve compared to patients that are in a complete response. But again, here, the differences between the red and the blue curve are not statistically significant different. I need to emphasize that this part of the curve is not informative yet. Yeah, so although you think that there is a difference, there are too few patients to make this assumption. Most of the patients are on that part of the curve. So you need to look really here in this area, and there's no difference. But what is very clear also is that when you look at the side effects of that treatment, is that with interleukin-2, which is a strong immunostimulatory hormone or molecule, is that you increase fever, you have more side effects, the patients are more sick, you have more allergic reactions, there's capillary leak, there's more hematological toxicity. So when we look at this in a very systematic way, you can acknowledge that in patients with IL-2, the bars shift to the right side, indicating that there's more side effects when we combine this antibody with interleukin-2 application. That's not surprising, but given the fact that we don't see so much additional activity, it indicates that IL-2 may not be so important for this type of treatment. This is another way of looking at this. When we address the so-called Lansky score, Lansky is a score which indicates the activity of a child and how well it is. So it goes from 0% to 100%, 100% being completely normal and 0% being basically unresponsive. We can acknowledge that a Lansky score of below 30% is significantly higher in patients that receive the combination of chimeric 1418 with IL-2. Also, the fever is higher, allergic reactions are higher, and also the capillary leak is higher. And the consequence of that is that the treatment cannot be completed in more patients in the IL-2 group compared to the patients that did not get the additional IL-2. Another information is also quite interesting, although this needs to be taken with a grain of salt because it's not built within one study, but one can see what the outcome is as reported by the Children's Oncology Group and compare the results to the European group. And what has been published is this two-year event-free survival rate of 66 plus minus 5%. For the immunotherapy as done by the COG, where you have a combination of IL-2 and GM-CSF. And when we look in a comparable patient cohort, where and these are only patients with complete remission that have been receiving this treatment, and if we look at a comparable patient cohort here in the European group, we also see a similar two event-free survival rate. So this is GD2 alone, 69 plus minus 6%, and this is with the IL-2, it's not different, but it compares very well with the result when you combine with IL-2 and GM-CSF, indicating that most likely chimeric 1418 is the most important component to the treatment, and most likely cytokines are not important. I wouldn't say they are completely ineffective. I cannot make this assumption, but there's a strong signal that these cytokines are not important to the treatment effect. Yes. Yes, so the study of this randomization was closed 2 years ago. Yeah. But you see that it's a spread out of patients. So this, for example, this patient is 6 years out since randomization, and then there's patients that are earlier, and therefore you need. Yeah. So it's spread out. So each tick here indicates, the time from where the patient are on the trial, and these are already quite robust data. But it's still not fair to look at this part of the curve because there's too few patients. So you need to look at the 2-year event-free survival. Yeah. No, I encourage you to ask these questions because then you understand also looking at these Kaplan-Meier curves because they are informative, but you should not when you read something, make wrong conclusions when you.
You mentioned in this slide that there's more cases where people discontinue immunotherapy. So could the reason that not finding correlation because people completely eliminated immunotherapy before they got the full course, and then you can't see the effect of the IL-2. Like perhaps if you ran the full course and only looked at people that continued the full course.
Absolutely correct. So we don't have enough patients yet enough numbers to give you a clear answer in this respect. But what is also important to consider is that if you cannot apply a treatment, then then it's not really worth.
When you talk about immunotherapy termination, does that mean they have to terminate it because they couldn't apply both, or they have to terminate it because could they have just stopped the IL-2 and continue immunotherapy?
Well, this is a matter of individual decision then by the center, but of course for the study, you have to document it accordingly. But you are completely right. I mean, from what we know or what we think we know is that it would make completely sense if you cannot tolerate the combination to eventually go on with only the chimeric 1418 antibody. If that answers your question. Okay, so this is also information from that study. So when we look at patients that are not in complete remission before immunotherapy, so in other words, they still have evaluable or measurable tumor, you can see that this treatment induces further responses. So for example, here we have a patient that responded to the induction treatment to some extent, but only achieved a partial response. So these are 50 patients. 16 of those move on to a complete response, and 14 to a very good partial response. There's 83 patients with a very good partial response, which then move on to a complete response in 38 cases. And then when you calculate numbers here, you can come up with a response rate, which indicates that there is also an additional effect really when you have a measurable tumor. Because, in the past, at least when I was in the lab studying these things, my mentor always said, well, this is something that doesn't work for bulky disease. It only works really for consolidation. So if you have a complete response, you can maintain this response, prevent relapse. But the more we test these treatments also in patients, for example, that have a relapse, we see that there's also something going on in terms of induction of responses in patients that have a measurable disease. Okay, so the summary of the frontline results so far. What we know right now, we have, oh, this is a spelling error. From the superimposable overall event field survival curves, as we know it of today, we see that there's hardly any effect of interleukin-2 in addition to chimeric 1418. When we compare the two-year event-free survival curves with the chimeric 1418 CHO alone, we have 69 plus minus 5%. And compared to the published result, although I mentioned already that this is difficult to compare between studies, however, we feel that the niveau of this type of effect we are achieving is quite comfortable. So I think this is quite a quite good signal from this type of treatment. Okay, I've spoken half an hour. I have another, if I go on like this, another hour to talk, but so maybe I have to shorten it a little bit. And I'd like to move to the relapse refractory setting, where we embarked on an effort to try to do something about a certain side effect that is associated with this treatment. So we know that GD2 is expressed on nerve cells, the so-called type C pain fibers, and we know that this antibody binds to these nerve fibers, and it therefore this treatment is associated with pain. And that's true for all antibodies that are directed against GD2. There's nothing you can do about that. But you can usually manage quite well when you treat these patients accordingly with good opioid analgesics, so usually IV morphine. The way this antibody is applied so far in clinical trials is summarized here with different cooperative groups. And this is usually given in 4 to 5 days in 8-hour infusions. And what we observed from clinical application is that when you have a patient receiving this antibody having pain despite all your analgesic treatment, you can deal with that situation by simply decreasing the speed of infusion of the antibody. So you go from an 8-hour to a 20-hour infusion. And this very simple observation we took forward to test in clinical trials. First, we tested it in a single-center program and then in a multi-center study where also Toby is participating. We call this the long-term infusion study because we give this antibody continuously over a quite significant prolonged time period. And yeah, we call this LTI. And the hypothesis is that with this method, we can improve the pain toxicity profile. And with that, we have completed 53 patients in a compassionate use program. And we have an ongoing study, which is now also randomizing IL-2, by the way, where we are quite well underway and hope to complete that study by the end of this year, as far as recruitment is concerned. That shows the treatment. So we have also the IL-2 included here. It started 2009. At that time, we were not informed of the result of the high-risk neuroblastoma study that we are conducting in Europe that just came out in 2014. So at that time, we still had the IL-2 implemented. But the important part is here, this continuous application of chimeric 1418. The same cumulative dose of 100 milligrams per square meter, but continuously over 10 days. And we started to look at the pain toxicity along that treatment by simply addressing how much IV morphine do we really need in order to keep a patient pain-free. And what you can see here is the application of the treatment. So it's the IL-2 here. There's nothing happening in terms of pain. And here's the IL-2 combined with chimeric 1418. And then we have always started with a standard dose of morphine to keep to be safe that there's no pain induction, and then ask the question, can you decrease the morphine over time? But of course the pain was not allowed, so the patient had to be pain-free over time. And what we observed is that you can really decrease the IV morphine from day to day until you can completely take it off in the majority of patients after 5 days, already in cycle one. Cycle two, only half of the patients need any morphine. Cycle three, cycle four, cycle five, and continues. It goes down, down, and down. And so indicating that this it's a known effect that the treatment tolerance becomes better from cycle to cycle, but with this type of treatment, you can really have patients without any IV morphine receiving this type of long-term infusion. What we also observed, which is very interesting to me because I don't fully understand the mechanism yet, is the fact that interleukin-2 significantly contributes to the IV morphine usage. So a patient that has IL-2 in addition to chimeric 1418 suffers more pain. I don't know why, because from what we understand of the mechanism of pain induction, we think that this is a complement-dependent effect, so a certain effector function of the antibody that uses proteins of the serum. And from in vitro studies and also mouse studies, we have clear evidence that the complement system is related to the pain induction, and IL-2 has no effect on the complement. So there's no mechanistical explanation why IL-2 causes more problems in this respect. Could be a subjective problem, because if you give IL-2 to a patient, such a patient is feeling quite sicklish, because it's like a bad flu that you induce with inflammation and fever. And if you then come in with something that eventually causes pain, you have a higher perception of pain. That could be that explanation. But anyway, I think what is really interesting is that with this long-term infusion, we have hardly any patient that needs morphine in cycle two, and in cycle three, we have no patient anymore that needs morphine. And that, I think, is a quite interesting effect that we are pursuing here. There's different ways of looking at this. We do not have a controlled study, short-term versus long-term infusion. Therefore, it is difficult to... But anyway, I think it's possible to compare with reported IV morphine usage from other studies. And when you look at the number that you need here, it's about one-fourth compared to the short-term infusion. And even when you have a mutated antibody, where the complement function is deleted, which is supposedly less painful. Also here, we need less morphine. In subsequent cycles, we do not have any information here, but here you can see that from cycle three on, you don't need any morphine here anymore. Okay, this is the overall toxicity profile comparing between studies. Difficult to interpret. However, all the parameters that we look at here are improved in terms of the capillary leak, fever, allergic side effects. So it looks all more favorable with the long-term infusion concept. This is looking at the response rate in the relapse refractory setting. Also here, we were quite encouraged by observing that patients that had a relapse or that are refractory and you apply this type of treatment, we can really see tumors disappear, complete responses, partial responses. And when we look at the end of the treatment, we have in this very difficult patient population a response rate of 32.4%. Okay, this is to try to get an idea of what the survival looks like in such a treatment regimen. Again, here it's not within one study, so one has to be very careful, but the signal that we are getting is quite encouraging. So when we have a quite well-matched control with long-term infusion patients in the that get this treatment in the relapsed setting only, and we compare to only relapsed patients in a control database from the Italian cooperative group, we see an interesting effect, so we feel quite comfortable that we are achieving something good with this type of treatment. No, this is just this combination, because it's very early developed now, and we have we did not randomize standard short term versus long term. Okay, I have one more minute. Therefore, I would like to jump to a few interesting perspectives. So the other stuff was just on the study. There was nothing exceptionally new as far as the overall concept is concerned. It's just basically confirms what we have done, and it's an ongoing study, and we are very excited about completing it soon and hopefully also see the data then in a multi-center setting. Now we have some future plans, and one plan is what to do with patients that completed the antibody treatment. And one possibility to, and this is what we are working on in the lab, but also have a clear perspective in moving this into application, is to immunize against GD2. And the concept of immunizing is difficult to explain, but what is not difficult is to mention that to immunize with GD2 is a problem, because that is not a protein, so it's not a molecule that induces a good immune response. So you need to find a way around that. And the way to do this is to find mimics that have a structural similarity to the GD2 and then use that for immunization. And one of such a mimic is a so-called anti-idiotypic antibody. And that is shown here. So what is an anti-idiotypic antibody? An anti-idiotypic antibody is an antibody that binds exactly to the recognition site of the parental antibody. Yeah, so it's this green one here. So it's exactly fitting in here. And this antibody recognizes GD2, and therefore the anti-idiotypic antibody is a mimic of the original antigen. So once you have such an anti-idiotype, you can immunize and then induce an anti-idiotypic antibody, which is then similar to the therapeutic one. So this antibody that you induce by immunization is able to bind GD2 and is not given in a passive way. Passive means that you infuse it all the time in certain weekly intervals. But here you have an immunization where this antibody should be produced by the patient himself in order to maintain an anti-GD2 immune response. So this is what we are working on. So we have made several anti-idiotypic antibodies for now, tested them in mice, and it looks quite promising, and we are very interested in moving this forward. It's not really available within a clinical trial yet, but this is a concept we are working on.
So that's after the...
And that would be something we would like to do after...
So
after.
They do the other therapy, the CH40, yeah. And then this is something new that you want to do
in addition, exactly,
in addition.
Yeah. Of course, there's other concepts, DMFO, for example, other treatments that are available, but we are working on this concept,
yes,
to make it... To make a sustainable anti-GD2 response in these patients.
How does this compare to the trial we're doing at Sloan at the moment for immunization?
Memorial Sloan Kettering has an anti-idiotypic antibody for their 3F8 program. Yes, this is correct. So it's from the as far as the concept is concerned, it's not different. It's very similar to that, yes. And then what we are also, and like many other people as well, are interested in is you to combine this concept with so-called checkpoint blockade. You may have heard about that as well. This is a new concept, not so new, but it's applicable to many cancers, where you have certain inhibitory molecules on tumor cells that shut down the immune system. And what has been done over the last years is to develop different monoclonal antibodies that block this inhibitory mechanism of these inhibitory molecules. And you call this immune checkpoint blockade. And one of these inhibitors is called nivolumab, so it's a monoclonal antibody that we are working on a clinical trial, at least on, in the protocol stage, where we will combine this with CH1418-CHO in order to see if this adds additional effect to the treatment. Okay, with this said, I'd like to close and briefly summarize or conclude that Chimeric 1418 is a really an effective substance for children with neuroblastoma. We have an interesting delivery method that we would like to continue to work on and hopefully can add other components to that treatment, such as checkpoint blockade inhibition or vaccination approaches. So this is always a team effort, and most importantly, the SIOPN group. And my team in the lab is shown here as well. There is a very important person here. It's Ralf Reisfeld. He made the Chimeric 1418 initially, way back in the 80s. And also some important funding mechanisms that we use in order to make these treatments available. Thank you very much.